you guys, welcome back to Better Biomed. Today we are going to take a look at a drive motor. Now this is a special type of motor I haven't gone over yet on this channel, and I wanted to show you guys because the typical process is if there's a doubt in a motor, people will just replace it. And as biomeds, we have a due diligence that's expected of us, and that is to actually detect and examine these type of motors and be able to troubleshoot what's going on. So I want to show you guys around this motor assembly and help you guys when it comes to troubleshooting these things so we can figure out what's going on with them when there's doubts, okay? Simple enough. Let's go ahead and take a look at what we got here. So this is a drive motor to a stretcher, and you can tell based on these little caps around the perimeter that this is a four-pole motor. So there's going to be two separate coils in here, and they have brushes. And these tiny little brushes are underneath the covers. And in order to get to them, we just pop these guys out. All right. So here is a carbon brush. And carbon brushes are basically what transmit electricity to the rotor, the piece that rotates. And it does this through a commutator. So the rotor rotates and there's little brass bars. We'll go ahead and take a look at all those. But these guys here can tell you a lot about what's going on inside your motor. So this brush looks absolutely fine. It's kind of large. What I want to do when I take a look at a brush is you look at the profile. The burn profile and the wear patterns are going to tell you a lot about the brush and about the rotor itself. So even though this brush is fine, the other ones might not be. All it takes is one brush to go bad, and it's going to affect your entire system. Oh, these are good. These are absolutely fine. Take a look at that. So when you do a lot of wear and tear on these motors, the brushes are consumable. These parts can be changed out. And brush motors, they're used when you need a lot of torque and you need an efficient motor. And you'll see, we're gonna open this bad boy up and we're gonna take a look. Now we have this four pole motor and it goes into a gear reduction drive. And inside here, there's probably going to be a quantity of oil, and they're probably submersed in the oil. So this guy here, it might spin at, let's say, 5,000-6,000 RPMs, and my output right here, you can see how much slop is in there, my output right here might only be 300 or 400 RPMs. So it could be a 10 or 20 to 1 ratio between how fast this guy spins and how fast this guy spins. And the spinning is controlled by your controller, which is up here underneath this piece. So let me flip this guy around and show you the controller. Now this guy had just come off a stretcher, so it's going to be dirty. And right here we have our power. There you guys, wanted to get you guys a better camera angle so that you guys can see a little bit better what I'm doing here. Oh yeah, this guy is incredibly heavy. So you have four poles, that's two coils, one on each side. Right here are your power wires, and I believe that this one here is going to be a thermistor wire, so it's going to monitor the temperature of the motor, or sometimes it could be a speed sensor, but I only count two wires, so that's what I'm saying, it's probably a thermistor. And down here is the controller. Now, one of the good things about the controller, you can see how shiny it is. It does have a conformal coating. That's why it's really shiny. Conformal coating is a coating that you place on control boards, PCBs, and it basically inhibits water from affecting the board. So everything has been dipped in it, you can tell. So right here is a interesting style of heatsink. So what they did is they just took a chunk of aluminum and they just stuck it right on there. There's no vanes, no nothing, probably because they expect minimal airflow.
So this basically tells you that the duty cycle of this motor is not expected to be very long, because what you're going to do is you're going to warm up this block, and then it's going to cool down when you park the stretcher. So other words, there'd be active cooling or something if the duty cycle was expected to be longer. This board is actually labeled quite well. Yeah, right there it says thermostat. So for your motor thermostat, it plugs in right here. So it is a thermocouple. This is your controller wire, which connects to your main control board. And down here, I have some ICs. And obviously this right here is your power. Really interesting. Okay. So you got one for one pair, one for the other pair. And I don't know, we might have one set for reverse. No idea. But anyway, that's the control board. Really interesting that they chose a solid chunk. It's gonna take, you know, a reasonable amount of heat. I guess while I'm down here at the bottom, I can show you the other things. Like, notice the screw right here. If you want to drain the lubricant out of this chamber, that right there would be how you do it. You pop that little screw out, drain it out, and then you're gonna fill it from the other side. Oh my goodness, this guy's heavy. Okay. All right. What do you think? Should I take the motor apart? I think let's do it. I'm gonna open up this hatch. Let's take a look inside the chamber. Let's see what we got going on in here. Let's see. Size. Yes. Here we go. Let's take a look in there. Oh yes, there we go. So it is filled with gear lube. Oh, very nice. Look at the quality of those gears. So this guy is definitely designed for some high torque. There's a bevel. It's a U-shaped bevel like that on the sprocket. Okay, so that's probably the interface with the worm drive from this guy. Oh yeah. A little bit of slop to the wheel, but not too much slop to the motor. Very cool. I'm gonna go ahead and put some of these fasteners back in because I don't want gear oil all over my bench. Okay, so here at the back of the motor, we're going to pull the end cap off, and it is going to create some problems with the brushes, so I got to remove all the brushes. Let's see, that is a Phillips. Let's see. One Phillips. This one. Okay, there we go. So I'm going to go ahead and pull these other brushes, and you will see why in just a moment. It's always nice to have a tool like this floating around. There we go. Wow, this thing is heavy. Okay, we got all the brushes out. Our commutator bars should be safe now to pull the end cap.
Wow. All right, here we go.
And there's two Phillips screws. All right. There we go. Yep, yep. Pull these guys out nice and easy. Wow, this motor is in beautiful condition. Very nice. Okay, so I got some cabling here down the side with zip ties I'm going to cut. There we go. Okay. And because the commutation happens down here at the end cap, oh, there we go. We have to be really careful of the wires. You can see that all the wires are hand soldered. How crazy is that? So right here, right here, right here, and right here. Very robust. Take a look at that solder pattern. So cool. All right, and let's see. I have, what is this guy? This is a Clixon 250 volt thermal fuse. So either that is a thermal fuse right here, or it is, I don't see a temperature rating. Is there? I've never taken one of these apart, guys, so you're in for the ride, same with me. So this is a T2A Bravo and a YS11A110 Bravo. No idea. Since it's got a voltage rating, I'd assume it's a thermal fuse. A lot of motors do have thermal fuses, but it could also be a thermistor. Not really sure. Anyway. Come on, baby. Come on. Wow. Wow. All right. Yes. What a perfect example. Okay, so let's go over some things. We have sealed bearings, first off. Take a look at that. That's how you know that this thing is made nicely. We have a thrust washer up here. So that adds a preload on the system. I have got some marks here for timing. See, 1, 2, 3, 4. Goes all the way up to 8. And the commutator bars are in beautiful condition. There's not even debris in between them. So this one here, I might take a 1200 grit sandpaper and rotate this bad boy and clean it up. But then again, that looks really nice. I don't detect any ridges whatsoever. That's beautiful. So anyway, this is the rotor. And these right here are the commutation bars. And right here, this is a sign that it's a very well-made product. You can see that they balanced it with some epoxy. You know, the other way of balancing is to cut into the rotor itself. But you can see that they balanced it using some weighted epoxy. But the true sign of a good-made part is that they epoxy all these leads right here that connect to the commutator bars, because those, due to vibration, are the weak points. Because copper, when it bends back and forth, it will work harden and then it will snap off. It gets dramatically weaker. So what they do is they epoxy all the leads to all this magnet wire here to the commutator bars, and that ensures that this is a long life part. And this is a very hefty motor. So guys, when I was saying that this is a 4-pole motor, take a look right there. There's your 4 poles. So there'll be 2 norths and 2 souths. These are permanent magnets. And yeah, they're pretty strong. So that's the what makes up a 4-pole system, is you'll have 2 norths and 2 souths. And then what they'll do is they will fluctuate the electricity coming in like this, using the 4 points. And that relates directly to different pairs of commutations right here, and those energize adjacent coils. And that is what gives you a very strong motor. So why is it that they choose four-pole motors? Well, a four-pole motor, when it's synchronous, which means that when the pulse and when the rotor rotate at the same exact speed, it will naturally rotate at a slower speed than a two-pole system. But the big but is that it has more torque, because look at the resolution. You have twice the amount of resolution, whereas a two-pole system will have one magnet on one side, one on the other, and it will just flip-flop north and south, north and south. Well, that doesn't give you very much resolution, and it definitely doesn't give you as much torque. This is a much more efficient system, and wow, this is a beast of a motor. I love it. It's absolutely beautiful. Take a look at that. Everything's epoxied. All the lines are epoxied down. Even way down here, the line is epoxied into the cap. Very nice. Completely enclosed. Oh, okay. I see how it's driven. This right here is your coupler. And then I make it go everywhere. So your coupler has a stainless steel pin, which interface right here. And then this guy has a blade, which interfaces with a pin right here. See the pin that's in there? So it interfaces with that shaft. And that's how you get motor drive. So interesting, isn't it? These are the motors that are in the bottom of stretchers. Now, it's well made, and that means it can probably be serviced. And if it's serviceable, that means you don't have to throw it out. You can change out, you can buy these brushes quite easily, and based on the wear pattern of the brushes, you can figure out whether or not your motor has got a problem. If it's got a lot of debris, you'll have broken into brushes. You can take a look down the brush hole. Let's take a look. You can take a look down the brush hole right there, and you can actually see the commutator bars. You can see these guys right here down the hole, and you can give it a surface inspection without ever opening up the motor. How cool, huh? So guys, since it's a four-pole system, it's still very easy to troubleshoot. What I do is on the wires, these guys right here, I'll stick my multimeter on it. And what I'm looking for is a good transition as I rotate the motor. Now this one here, since it's in a gear reduction drive, you can't just rotate it via the wheel. It doesn't work like that because the gear reduction has got too much of a drag. So you'd have to actually pull the back of the motor apart. That's gonna be a pain. It's not going to be an easy one to troubleshoot. What I can tell you is you should inspect the brushes if you ever are not getting a drive signal. And definitely on each of the pairs, put an oscilloscope is what I would do, and check and see if you've got a pulse. You should have a pulse going to each of the two coils. So while one coil is pulsing up, the other coil is pulsing down. So it's, think of it as two almost sine waves. It's probably a square wave though. So like while one coil is pulsing positive, the other one's pulsing negative. And what it's doing is it's inverting the polarity. And that is what gives it all that extra torque, is having all those pulls. But there you go, guys. A stretcher drive motor. And it's a fascinating piece. I'd say they took a lot of care when they manufactured this part. And they use premium components. Anyway, guys, that's all I got for you. Stretcher drive motors, four pole, DC brushed. It's a good motor, looks interesting. And I'm glad that I snagged this part from the trash to show you guys what's inside it. Let me know what you think, guys. I'm going to be probably doing more of these common teardowns. So let me know if you guys want me to do more videos like this one in the future. Thanks for watching.